Good morning, Vandal. Today we are going to introduce discrete time systems. Let us have a brief look into discrete time systems. This block represents discrete time processing of continuous time signals. It means the input to this overall system is continuous and output of the system also continuous here. Both are continuous, but we want to process this continuous time signal with the help of a discrete time system. That can be done as follows. First, we will try to convert this continuous time signal into discrete signal with the help of continuous to discrete converter. After that, we will try to process that with the help of a discrete time system. Followed by, once again, we will try to convert discrete time signal back to continuous time signal, because the input of discrete time system is discrete signal and output also discrete signal. We need to convert this discrete signal back to continuous signal. That's what we are doing here. In order to do this, there are constraints we need to follow. Can you tell me what are the constraints? Yeah, what are the constraints that you require? We have gone through sampling theorem, right? Yeah, what are the constraints that we need to satisfy? Yeah, you can answer, right? Otherwise, you can type. That's also fine for me. The sampling rate constraint is there, right? What is the constraint? The sampling rate, FS. We are trying to follow capital FS notation, right? FS should be greater than or equal to 2 times maximum frequency of that baseband message signal, right? This we need to satisfy. According to sampling theorem, we need to satisfy this constraint, right? Where T equals to 1 by FS. That's what we need to do. In this way, we can try to process continuous time signals with the help of a discrete time system. We need to convert that into discrete signal first. Then after, we can process that with the help of a discrete system. After that, we can reconvert this discrete signal back to continuous time signal with the help of digital to analog conversion. Yeah, what kind of digital to analog conversion we are using? Which circuit we are using in order to convert discrete time signal to analog signal? What is that filter? We are using analog reconstruction filter, right? Yeah, you can respond, right? Analog reconstruction filter. What is that? Is it low pass, high pass, or band pass? Low pass, right? In general, what is the cutoff frequency for that? In place of digital to continuous conversion, discrete to continuous conversion, we are using low pass filter, analog low pass filter, with a cutoff frequency equals to FS by 2, right? In general, this is what we are following. This corresponds to that one. And let's have a look into this functional block diagram of DSP system. If that is a continuous time signal, if the input is a continuous time signal, first we will try to convert that with the help of ADC, analog digital conversion circuit. This is an anti-aliasing filter. In order to avoid aliasing effect, this should be a low pass filter with a cutoff frequency of FS by 2, where FS is the sampling rate. Once you convert to digital, that can be processed with the help of digital signal processing hardware. The output of DSP is once again digital. Input is digital, output is digital. We can convert back to analog with the help of digital to analog conversion circuit. DAC. DAC along with the combination of reconstruction filter. DAC will try to convert this digital signal into discrete signal. After that, we will try to pass through low pass filter. This will try to smooth that signal and we are going to get back to our signal via VT. In some application, our actual input itself will be digital. In such scenario, you don't require this block, right? In such scenarios, your expected output will be digital. No need to convert back to analog, right? Yeah, that's fine. A discrete time system is defined mathematically as a transformation or operator that maps an input sequence with values x of n into an output sequence with values y of n. It's a mapping from x of n to y of n. Discrete time system. Y of n equal to transformation. This corresponds to transformation t of x of n. Just have a look into these notations. It's a transformation. We are trying to transform x of n into output sequence y of n. This is input sequence. This is output sequence. Y at time n can depend on all or part of the entire sequence x. This is a representation block for the discrete time system. Input to discrete time system is a system. System or a transformation. This block. And input to this one is discrete time system, discrete time input. And output of this system also discrete output, right? X of n is the discrete input, y of n is the discrete output. Ideal delay system. Y of n equal to x of n minus nd for all n integer. N should be integer, n belongs to z. If nd equal to 2, what is the meaning of that one? Is it a delay system or advanced?
Delayed by 2.
Okay, delayed by 2 samples, right? Delayed by 2 samples is nothing but delayed by 2t. Because each sample to sample gap is t, right? Where t equals to 1 by fs, sampling period. If I say delayed by 2 samples means delayed by 2t seconds, where t equals to 1 by fs. Here, delayed by nd samples, where nd is an integer. Delayed by nd samples is nothing but delayed by nd into t, where t is sampling period, right? Nd into t equals 1 by fs. And if you have, for example, nd equals to minus 3, then that is advanced by 3 samples. It will be x of n plus 3, right? Advanced by 3 samples. Moving average system. This is a moving average system. Y of n equal to 1 by m1 plus m2 plus 1, sigma k equal to minus m1 to m2, x of n minus k. Let us have a look into some example of moving average system. Let me consider some moving average system as follows. X of n minus 1 plus x of n minus, okay, n plus 1 divided by, what should be this one? If this is moving average system, what should be this? Average of 3 samples means 3, right? We have a look into this. This is, if you expand this one, we are going to get this. If you try to expand this summation, we are going to get this one. The total number of terms, if you try to count these terms, the number of terms we are having is m1 plus m2 plus 1. These many number of terms we are having in this summation, we are dividing by total number of terms. 1 divided by m1 plus m2 plus 1, right? We are doing the same thing here. We are having total 3 terms. Divided by total number of terms, right? 3. We have n equal to this one. This is an example of moving average system. This is nothing but, yeah, in that format I want to write. Let me have the same notations, k, right? Sigma k equal to, in this particular example, k equals to minus 1 to 1, minus 1 to plus 1, x of n minus k divided by 3, right? This 3 is nothing but, you can have a look into this. 1 minus half minus 1 plus 1, right? you try to compare with this one. This is minus m1, this is m2, right? Where m1 and m2 are positive constants in this case. Here, minus m1 equals to minus 1 and m2 equals to 1. This will be m1 plus m2 plus 1, right? M1 plus m2 plus 1. Minus m1 equal to minus 1 means m1 equal to 1. M2 equal to 1. 1 plus 1 plus 1. 3, right? The moving average system. Let me have a look into some example. Minus 1, yeah, and so on. Let me consider these are zeros. Index minus 1, say n, index, integer, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is my x of n. Let me consider this as my x of n, the n x of n. And all others are zeros at all other integers, 5, 6, 7, and so on. And if I consider this as my moving average system, then what will be my y of, what will be my y of minus 3? What will be my y of minus 3? Can someone answer? Y of minus 3 means n equal to minus 3, I need to substitute, right? X of minus 4 plus x of minus 3 plus x of minus 2 by 3. 0 plus 0 plus 0 by 3, right? Because you can see, x of minus 2 is 0, x of minus 3 is 0, x of minus 4 also 0, right? That equal to 0. Then what will be my y of minus 2? Yeah, what is y of minus 2? Yeah, please you can respond. What is y of minus 2? Replace n with minus 2, right? X of minus 3 plus x of minus 2 plus x of minus 1, n with minus 2. This will be minus 1, right? X of minus 1 is non-zero. This will be x of minus 1 divided by 3, right? Because remaining terms are zeros, 0 plus 0. Can someone answer, what is y of minus 1? What is y of minus 1? Yes, I get two examples, right? You can fill this. Can someone answer this? What is y of minus 1? Replace n with minus 1. Yeah, what is y of minus 1? Y of minus 1 is nothing but x of minus 2 plus x of minus 1. Yeah.
Y of minus 1 plus y of 0 by
x of minus 1
plus x of 0 by 3.
Yeah, because this term is 0, right? X of minus 2 is 0. And we are going to have y of 0 equals to x of minus 1 plus x of 0 plus x of 1 divided by 3, right? And y of 2, for example, just go for y of 2. Y of 2 equals to x of 1 plus x of 2 plus x of 3 divided by 3, right? X of 1 means this one. X of 2 plus x of 3 divided by 3. This particular index we are considering. You can have a look into this. What we are having is n index. This is same. One sample left side, one sample right side we are going. And we are taking average of those things. That's what we are doing, right? The averaging operation is nothing but smoothing. If you try to take average of samples, it will try to smooth your signal. A smoothing operation or some kind of low pass filtering operation. Okay, you might heard about this, right? In continuous time case, integrator and differentiator. Okay, which one corresponds to low pass filter and which one corresponds to high pass filter? When coming to continuous time case, you might heard this somewhere in E2 itself. Might be network theory also. In continuous time, integrator corresponds to low pass filtering operation. Differentiation corresponds to high pass filtering operation. High pass filtering. This will try to smooth the signal. Low pass filtering means it will try to smooth the input signal. It will try to make the signal like sharper. High pass filtering operation. Here, this is somewhat similar to that integration operation. The averaging, right? Adding. In discrete case, you will try to add. Continuous case, you will go for integration. Discrete case, you will go for summation, right? After that, divide by some constant. Is something similar to that operation, smoothing operation or low pass filtering operation. We are going to see this later. Even you might recollect based on this when coming to continuous case. Is RC low pass filter. RC low pass filter is input Vi of t, output V naught of t. What is the relation between this and this? You might find some sort of integration operation. Yeah, this you can see later. Might be like this. Yeah, I'm not sure. You need to cross check that. When coming to high pass system, you might get like a differentiator. When you are taking the output across this one, you might get something like differentiation of input, some sort of that. It's a high pass system. Low pass means it will try to smooth the signal. High pass means it will try to make the signal like sharper. Is some sort of smoothing operation or some kind of low pass filtering operation. This one. Moving average system. We'll try to see that later, that analysis. Memoryless system. The system is referred to as memoryless if the output Y of n at every value of n depends only on the current input X of n, then you can call it as a memoryless system. Okay, I'll give some examples. Can you comment whether it is a memoryless system or not? Let me go for ideal delay system. Y of n equals to X of n minus 2. Is it memoryless system or memory system?
Memory.
It has memory. Memory of two samples. This is memory. And y of n equals to x of n plus 2. Is it having memory? Is it memory system or memoryless?
Memoryless.
Memoryless system, right? Because the current output is function of only current input, present input, right? This index remains same for both of them. It's not function of future input, or it's not function of past input. This is called as memoryless system. Memoryless system, right? And what about y of n equal to x of n plus x of n plus 1? Is it memory system? Memory system or memoryless? Yeah, can you use, oh, memory, right? That's having memory. The system is having memory due to this one. It's not just function of present input, function of future input also. And y of n equals to x of n whole square. Is it memory or memoryless? Yeah, is it memory or memoryless? Y of n equals to x of n whole square.
Memoryless?
Yes, memoryless system, right? That is just function of present input. It's not function of future input or not a function of past input. It's a memoryless system. This is having memory. This is also having memory. Linear system. Yeah, you can try to map this one to your signals and systems course only, more similar to that one. Exactly. Suppose x1 of n is the input and the output we are going to get is y1 of n. x2 of n is the input. Output of the system is y2 of n. A x1 of n plus B x2 of n implies what should be that one if that is linear system. In order to say that is a linear system where A and B belongs to some real constants, they are constants, then what should be the output if that is a linear system?
Addition of output.
Of, yeah, what should be that one?
A y1 plus okay. B y2, sir.
Yes. B y2 of n. Then you can call it as a linear system. If that's by this condition, that's a linear system. This is known as superposition. Superposition property. That should satisfy superposition property. The system should satisfy superposition property. Then you can call it as a linear system. Superposition is nothing but additivity and homogeneity. Additivity and homogeneity. Okay, what is additivity means? X1 of n plus x2 of n implies output should be y1 of n plus y2 of n. Then we can call it as additivity. Homogeneity means A times x1 of n or A times x of n should lead to A times y of n. This is homogeneity. Additivity and homogeneity together called as superposition. That should be additive and that should be homogeneity. Then you can call it superposition and the system responding to that one is a linear system. Linearity, if and only if, this is known as if and only if. Superposition satisfied. Additivity and homogeneity. The generalization of that statement. Suppose x of n equal to sigma k ak fk of n implies y of n equals to sigma k ak yk of n. The generalization of that one. It means for example, yeah, what's the meaning of that is, if this is the output we are going to get for that given system, where k equals to 1, 2, 3, and so on, then if you go for linear combination of these inputs, ak, xk of n, k equal 1, 2, 3, and so on, implies output should be linear combination of these corresponding outputs, ak, yk of n. This is a generalization of that superposition principle. Examples for linear system. Ideal linear system is a linear system. Okay, why this is a linear system, ideal linear system? See, ideal delay system means output y of n should be x of n minus nd, where nd is some constant. For example, consider nd equal to some 2. Y of n equals to x of n minus 2. Why this is a linear system? Ideal linear system is a linear system. Just have an example on this. Y1 of n equal to x1 of n minus 1. When the input is x1 of n, output is y1 of n. X1 of n minus 2. And when the input is x2 of n, output is y2 of n. which is y x2 of n minus 2. Like this we got. Now, if my input is 2x1 of n, just for example, 3x2 of n, if this is my input, according to linearity, I need to get this, right? N minus 1 plus 3x2 of n minus 2. Let me call whole thing with x of n. I'm calling this as my new input x of n. X of n equal to 2x1 of n plus 3x2 of n. And if I apply x of n as an input to this ideal relay system, I'm going to get output as x of n minus 2, right? X of n minus 2 is my concerned output. We have n equal x of n minus 2. And what is my x of n minus 2? I know this whole thing corresponds to x of n. X of n minus 2 corresponds to replacing n with n minus 2, right? Replace n with n minus 2. Then I am going to get equal to this, right? Equal to this. This is nothing but y1 of n. This is nothing but y2 of n. Then you can say this is a linear system. Ideal relay system is a linear system. Moving average system is also a linear system. Moving average system is a linear system. Is it true or false?
Why true, equal to? Because
yeah. Yes.
Because it is a linear combination of shifted samples, right? That's why.
Yes. This is also a linear system. Minus m1 to m2. X of n minus k. K equal minus m1 to m2. Suppose my input is x1 of n. The output I am going to get is 1 by m1 plus m2 plus 1. Sigma k equals to minus m1 to m2 x1 of n minus k. If my input is x2 of n, then the concerned output I am going to get is 1 by m1 plus m2 plus 1 sigma k equals to minus m1 to m2 x2 of n minus k. And when my input is the combination of both, x of n equals to a into x1 of n plus b into x2 of n, and my input is like this one, then according to moving average system, I need to expect my output as follows. M2, it should be x of n minus k. It should be x of n minus k. And I know that I'll simply replace x of n minus k with this. This x of n minus k is nothing but a times replace n with n minus k both sides, right? X of n minus k means x1 of n minus k plus b into h2 of n minus k. I substitute this into this expression. In place of x of n minus k, I replace this one. And after that, as is an addition, I can simply try to split this into two parts. I replace this term with this. After that, what I am going to do is, I can write this like a into sigma x1 plus b into sigma x2. Then that is nothing but a into y1 of n plus b into y2 of n. You can simplify this and you can cross check. That is same as this. Moving average system also a linear system. Y of n equal x of n whole square is a nonlinear system. Why? I am claiming that this is a nonlinear system. Why this is non-linear? Let me cross check this. For x1 of n, I am going to get y1 of n as x1 of n whole square, right? Similarly, for x2 of n input, I am going to get output as follows. If my input is linear combination of both, for example, let me go with additivity property only. I am just considering a equal to b equal to 1. It's a case, right? That should be valid for any a and b. If you want, you can go with a, b. That's also okay. There's no issue with this one. X2 of n. Now, my output will be y of n equal x of n whole square. It means ax1 of n plus bx2 of n whole square, which is not equals to ay1 of n plus by2 of n. This is not equal to this one, because we are going to get a square x1 square plus b square x2 square plus 2ab x1 x2, which is not equal to this one. y1 of n means this, y2 of n means this one. Then you can say this is not a linear system. Accumulator system. Accumulator system is nothing but y of n equal to this is an accumulator system. Sigma k equals minus infinity to n x of k. This is known as accumulator system. For example, I want to know what is my y of 1. Then this is nothing but, yeah, can someone tell me what is this? This expansion. Let me go with last term. Last term is k equal to minus infinity to 1, right? Sigma k equal to minus infinity to 1, x of 1. Then what is the term before that in this summation?
Of 0.
Yes, x of 0, x of minus 1, plus x of minus 2, and so on, till x of minus infinity. And y of 2 equals to this whole thing, plus x of 2, right? Can I say like this? Is it true or false? Y of 2, I am claiming that equals to y of 1 plus x of 2. Because this is sigma k equals to minus infinity to 2 x of k. If I add plus x of 2 to this one, I am going to get y of 2. Y of 3, can I write like this? Y of 2 plus x of 3. I am trying to write in recursive manner, recursive equation. Because I know y of 2 is nothing but this whole summation plus x of 1 plus x of 2, that is y of 2. If I add plus x of 3 to that one, I am going to get y of 3. Like this I can write, right? And then, can I write like this? Y of n equal to y of n minus 1 plus x of n for accumulator. Is it true or false? Is it okay or any mistake there in this?
True, sir.
Yeah, this is true, right? If you want, you can write like this. Minus infinity to n minus 1. I know y of n, right? Y of n equal to sigma k equals to minus infinity to n. Y of n minus 1 means replace n with n minus 1 both sides. A is minus infinity to n minus 1, x of k plus x of n. This is nothing but sigma k equals to minus infinity to n, x of k. Both are equal. I can write in this manner, right? In recursive. Instead of writing like infinite summation, I can try to write with two terms. in a recursive manner. The past output, the past output, present input, as a combination of past output and present input, right? It's an accumulator system. Instead of writing infinite summation, I can simplify in this manner. Accumulator system is also a linear system. If you want, you can cross-check in the same manner. Try to consider x1 of n input, then the output will be y1 of n equal to sigma k equals to minus infinity to n x1 of k. For y2, this will be x2 of k. Now try with the x of n equal to ax1 of n plus bx2 of n. Then you are going to get linearity property. That will be satisfied. There is no doubt. And this is a non-linear system. If you want, you can cross-check. Just go with the additivity property, for example. If you go with x1 of n, y1 of n equal to log 10 x1 of n mod. This is undefined for negative, right? And y2 of n equal to log 10 mod x2 of n. If my input x of n equal to x1 of n plus x2 of n, then y of n equal to log 10 mod x of n. I'll replace x of n with x1 of n plus x2 of n. Then I won't get like y1 of n plus y2 of n. Okay, can I write like this? Is it true or false? Log mod x1 plus x2. Is it equal to log mod x1 plus log mod x2? Is it true or false? Is it true? Log a b equal to log a plus log b, right? This is true, but this is not true. This is false. That additivity property violated, right? Similarly, you can cross check that homogeneity. If you want, you can try with a into x. You are going to get log a plus something, right? Which is not same as a into y1. In that way, also that will fail. Yeah, it's non-linear system. Time invariant system. Time invariant or shift invariant system is a system for which time shift or delay of the input sequence causes a corresponding shift in the output sequence. Can someone define what is the exact meaning of time invariant system? Time invariant system, there is a meaning in the statement itself, right? Time invariant system. It won't vary with respect to time, right? For example, let me consider some circuit, ideal circuits, all are ideal circuits. Let me go with R1, R2. If the input is 10 volts, R1 equal to 1 kilo ohm exactly, and this is not varying, this ideal resistance, like that you can think. Then what is my output? V0. Yeah, what is the output? Input is 10 volts. This resistor is 1 kilo ohm. This resistor is 1 kilo ohm. And what is the output voltage across R2? See, you can answer, right? Yeah, 5 volts. Someone answered 5 volts, right? Yeah. You see, 5 volts, right? The output is 5 volts. If I do the same experiment tomorrow, or maybe some other time, I did the experiment now and I got the output as 5 volts. If I repeat the same experiment tomorrow with same resistors and same voltage, if they are ideal, will I get the same output voltage? Will I get same or different? Same or different?
You don't get same.
You'll get same, right? If they are ideal, we'll get the same thing. Then that is known as time invariant system. If I repeat the experiment in some other time for the same input, I should get the same output for that given system. Then you can call it as time invariant system. Those are ideal systems, right? Yeah, those are ideal systems. But if I change the temperature, for example, I'm changing the temperature of those resistors. For example, let now that is at 15 degrees centigrade. Let me consider those resistors are at 15 degrees centigrade. And after 1 hour, if I try to heat the resistors, after heating, the temperature became like 80 degrees centigrade. Just for example, then do you think the output remains same? Will it be same or different if I heat those resistors and those are not ideal? Okay, they are different, right? You can expect the output will be different then. They need not be same. And consider non-ideal resistors. The resistance values might change with temperature and even thermal noise will be added, right? There will be some thermal noise. Due to that, that output might fluctuate slightly. Then that's not a time invariant, that's time varying system in such scenario. Yeah, that's the exact meaning behind time invariant system. At least on paper, you can find some time invariant systems. Forget about analog, at least in digital, you can find time invariant systems, right? If you try to repeat the experiment today and tomorrow or day after tomorrow in your DEC lab, digital electronic circuits lab, at least you can find the output, right? Due to that thresholding property, you are able to get same discrete voltage. Voltage need not be same. That binary output you are going to get, it will be remain same. For example, if you are using inverter. Inverter means if the input bit is 0, output should be 1. If the input bit is 1, output should be 0, right? At least you can get the feel of that one. That will be time invariant system. Yeah, this is the meaning of that. If input, if you delay the input by nd samples, then output also should be delayed by nd samples. Exact output you are getting, same output you are getting. Suppose input is x of n, output is y of n. Now, if you delay the input by nd samples, output also should be delayed by nd samples. Same output y you are getting, but delayed by nd samples like your input. Then you can call it as time invariant system. Some examples of time invariant system are accumulator system is a time invariant system. Accumulator system is a time invariant system. Is it true or false? Minus infinity to n. X of k. This is an accumulator system. I'm claiming that this is a time invariant system. It means, for example, I consider my input as a delayed version of x of n. Delayed by two samples, for example. N d equal to 2, I consider. Then according to this statement, y1 of n equal to, if input is x1 of n, output should be y1 of k summation, right? No, this is x1. X1 of k, sigma k will minus infinity to n. This is my output of the accumulator system. Now, I will replace x1 of k with this term. X1 of n equal to x of n minus 2. Then what will happen? Sigma k equals to minus infinity to n x of k minus 2. X1 of k equal to x of k minus 2. Replace n with k both sides. Is it true or false? I am claiming that this is equal to y of n minus 2. Is it true or false? Okay, y of n minus 2 equal to This is y of n, right? Replacing n with n minus 2 both sides. Sigma k goes to minus middle 2, n minus 2, x of k. This is my y of n minus 2. I am claiming that this one is same as this one. These two are equal. Is it true or false? Someone answered they are different. Okay, this is long back, right? Yeah. Is it same or different? See, these two are equal. If you want, you can do, you can apply some trick. Let me consider k minus 2 as k dash. Some notation, k dash. Replace this one with k dash and try to change the limits. Now it will be k dash instead of k. If you substitute k equal to minus infinity, lower limit in this one, minus infinity minus 2 is nothing but minus infinity, right? Lower limit is unchanged. And what about upper limit? Replace k equal to n. K equal to minus infinity to n, right? Replace k equal to n in this. This will be n minus 2, right? K dash equal to n minus 2. N minus 2. K dash equal to minus infinity to n minus 2. X of k dash, that is exactly same as this one, right? In place of k, I have k dash, but this summation range is same in both cases, right? These two are identical. It's a time invariant system, accumulator system. Okay, what about compressor system? Is it time varying or time invariant system? Y of n equal to x of mn, where m is some positive integer greater than 1. See, just for an example, let me go with this. Let's say n, some x of n. Let me have this one like 1, 2, 3, and this is minus 1, this is 1, let me say this is minus 2, and let me have this one as 0, 1, 2, 3 indices, 4 and 5, and remaining all are zeros at minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and so on. Similarly, zeros this side. Can someone tell me what is x of 2n? X of 2n. Let me call this as x1 of n. X1 of n equals to x of 2n. Yes. Can someone answer what is my x of 2n?
It's 0. We have amplitude 1.
Yes. Yeah. Because 2n equal to 0. Yeah. What I said is you can equate 2n to 0. Then n equal to 0. This will be shifted to 0 only in the same location. And 2n equals to 1 implies n equal to 1 by 2. This is undefined at n equal to 1 by 2, right? We'll remove this after this operation. That will be removed. 2n equal to 2 implies n equal to 1. This will be shifted to n equal to 1. And this will be nullified, right? 2n equal to 3. N equal to 3 by 2. Fraction at fraction undefined. N equal to 4, n equal to 2. This is shifted to n equal to 2. 1, right? And n equal to 5, n equal to 5 by 2. The fraction. We are considering alternate samples, right? We are removing alternate samples with this operation. And zeros, all others are zeros. Similarly, all others are zeros. This is x of 2n. This is our x of 2n. Now, let me consider x of n minus 1. X of n minus 1. This is my input. And let me represent this with some x2 of n. X2 of n equal to x of n minus 1. This is my updated input. Updated input. Okay, 1, 2, 3, minus 1, 1, minus 2. 1, 2, minus 1, 1, minus 2. Minus 1, 1, minus 2. Okay. But this will be shifted to 1, right? X of n minus 1 I am doing. Delaying this sequence by one sample. So it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All others are zeros. This is x of n minus 1. Now if I do this operation, x2 of 2n, after delay, I am doing x2 of 2n. Then what the output I am going to get? Yes, what should be this? Will it be there?
No.
Because 2n equals to 1, n equal to 1 by 2, the fraction not allowed, right? 2n equal to 2, n equals to 1. This will be shifted to equal to 1. Yeah, to 1, right? So 2. And this will be removed, odd part, right? 2n equal to 3, fraction. 2n equal to 4 means n equal to 2. At n equal to 2, we are getting minus 1. And at n equal to 3, we are going to get minus 2. This is minus 2. This is my x2 of 2n. This is my x2 of 2n. This is my x of 2n. This is my output system, right? Oh, this is my output system. Y of n. Let me call it as y of n. This is y of n equals to x of 2n. This is output of that system. My system is compressor system, right? Here I can say m equal to 2. I got this as my output. Do you think this one is equal to y of n minus 1? Is it true or false? According to time invariant system, if I delay the input by one sample, output also should be delayed by one sample. Is it true or false? This is my output y of n in earlier without delay, right? If I delay this by one sample, then what is my y of n minus 1? Y of n minus 1. This is my y of n. This will be shifted by 1, right? This will become 1, 2, 3. And the amplitudes are 1, 3, 1. 1, 3, 1. 1, 2, 3. This is my y of n minus 1. Do you think this y of n minus 1 is same as this x2 of 2n? Are they equal or different? You can see this sequence and this sequence. Are they equal? See, they are different, right? They are not equal. So we can say that this is not a time invariant system. It's a time varying system. Compressor system is a time varying system. And causal system. A system is causal if for every choice of n naught, the output sequence value at index n naught depends only on the input sequence values for n less than good n naught. Okay, what is the exact meaning of causal system? You might have heard this in single cell systems also, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is that meaning? Causal system. Oh, Gautam, you want to say something, right? Yeah, what is the meaning of causal system? See, causal system means the current output should not be function of future inputs, right? The current output should not depend on future inputs. That's a causal system. That should be depend on either present input and or past input. But that should not depend on, that should not depend on future inputs. That's a causal system. This is the meaning of that. This is the mathematical meaning of that. We can have a look into this. Other system examples. y of n equals to x of n minus 2. Is it a causal system? Yes, you can respond. We'll try to wind up this fast. Yeah. Is it causal system?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Because its output is a function of past input, but not future, right? It's not a function of future. It's a causal system. Okay, what about y of n equals to x of n plus x of n plus 3 minus 2? Is it causal or non-causal?
Non-causal.
Non-causal, right? Due to this factor, it's a function of future, right? Function of future, so we can call it as non-causal system. Function of future means, see, in future I don't know what input I am going to get, and I am trying to predict based on my future input, right? It's highly impossible. It's not practically feasible, right? You can't guess the input, what the future input I am going to get. And you can have into this. And y of n equal x and whole square is also a causal system. Where there is a function of present input, right? It's not a function of future inputs. Accurate system is causal. It's also causal. You can have into this. And yeah, compressor system is non-causal for m greater than 1. Why? Let me consider this example only. For example, this is my input. This is my output y of n. Then what is my y of 0? Yeah, what is my y of 0? Let me consider y of n equals to x of 2n. Then what is my y of 0?
X of 0.
0, x of 0. N equal to 0 both sides. What is y of 1? X of 2. Two. Y of 2 equals to x of 4. This is a function of future, right? This present is n equal to 1. Future is n equal to 2. Present n equal to 2. This is future for present, right? You can try to have a look into that. This is actually coming in future, right? F2. It's trying to predict the future. This is non-causal system, right? For m greater than 1. Forward difference system. This is a non-causal system. Forward difference means the function of future. Function of a future sample, right? X of n plus 1 minus x of n. Backward difference system is a causal system. This is past. This is future. Stable system. A system is stable in the bounded input, bounded output sense if and only if every bounded input sequence produces a bounded output sequence. This is the mathematical representation. You can have a look into this. It's just a representation of your signals and systems course, this part. And you can note down this statement. An unstable system may have some bounded inputs for which the output is bounded. Unstable system may have some bounded inputs, for which output is bounded. If this is failing at least for one example, then you can say that is unbounded or unstable. For stability, that should satisfy. For all bounded inputs, that should be bounded output. For all possible bounded inputs. If at least for one bounded input, you are writing unbounded output, then you can call it as unstable. Stable system examples. We have an equal experiment for space. It's a stable. Can someone give me the explanation why this is a stable system? Suppose x of n is finite or bounded, Let me construct x of n equal to some 10,000. Y of n equal to 10,000 whole square. 10,000 whole square is also bounded, right? That is less than infinity. That's a bounded, right? Magnitude of this one, that one is less than infinity. It's a stable system. Y of n equal to log x of n is unstable. Why? Yeah, why? That is unstable.
Zero, we don't get this. Bounded.
Zero, up. Right? Yeah, that is true. Log zero base 10. If suppose x of n equal to zero. Zero can be written like 10 power minus infinity. It's nothing but minus infinity, right? Anything more than 1 whole power minus infinity leads to zero, right? It's minus infinity, unbounded output I am getting, right? Or bounded input, I'm getting unbounded output. At least one example I can give like that, right? I can call it as unstable system. Accumulate system is unstable. Why? I can go with this example. X of n equal to u of n. U of n is nothing but equal to 1 for all n greater than or equal to 0. U of n equal to 1 for all n greater than or equal to 0. And my accumulator system is as follows. Y of n equal to sigma k equals to minus infinity to n x of k. Then what is my y of 1? Let me consider x of n equal to u of n. And what is my y of minus 1? This is my u of n. Input u of n. And all are 1s. 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Minus 1, minus 2, and so on. This side, that is zeros. Y of minus 1 is nothing but sum of all these values, right? Till minus 1. This is the meaning. N equal to minus 1 if you substitute. This is 0. All others are 0. Below minus 1 index. What is y of 0? Y of 0 is nothing but sum of all inputs till x of 0, right? This summation is 1. What is y of 1? Yeah, 1 of you can answer. What is y of 1? This entire summation, right? 1 plus 1, 2. Okay, what is y of 2? Yeah, what is y of 2? 3, right? Yeah. Y of 2 is nothing but 3. And what is y of n for n greater than or equal to 0? I'm going to get like n plus 1. Y of 2 is nothing but 2. 3. Y of n should be n plus 1, right? When n is positive. If n tends to infinity, then what is y of n? It's also tends to infinity, right? If n is becoming larger and larger, y of n also becoming larger and larger, it's tending to infinity, right? So you can call it as unbounded output. But the input is still bounded. You can see, even for n tends to infinity, my input x of n is always 1. U of n tends to infinity is 1, right? Because u of n equal to 1 for all n greater than or equal to 0. This is still bounded input. My input is bounded even for n tends to infinity. But my output is approaching to infinity, right? For bounded input, I am getting unbounded output. So that is unstable system. And you can have, yeah, you can try to verify this. These are also stable systems. Ideal linear system, moving average, compressor systems. Thank you. Okay, do you have any doubts?